Today we're going to talk about not only herbs, but also spices and the importance of spices to the ancient world. So we're still getting into the history lesson here. Some of the spices that are on this table at one point were worth their weight in gold. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine a time when it wasn't so simple to go to eat your dinner and find a bottle of free black pepper and free salt, right? Pepper, black pepper, came from India, Sri Lanka, that part of the world. To get it all the way to Europe, it was a highly valued spice. Remember, pre-1492, black pepper that came via Arab intermediaries from the East into Europe was the only spicy, hot-tasting condiment that Europeans had access to. Okay, and so when red pepper came about post-1492, you saw a huge shift in importance of black pepper, but it still is important today, so we find it on our table. We're going to go over these spices. We're going to focus mainly on how spices and the spice trade impacted European history, and we're going to talk a bit about what was going on in the Americas as well. And we're going to talk about the relationships between the spice trade and globalization events, and how spices reshaped different parts of the world in terms of culture and economy. And then we're going to think about this in terms of, thank you, of globalization, and how does this apply to today? So, let's first start with this idea of the food-medicine continuum. Have you ever heard of that term before? The food-medicine continuum? The idea is that I could take, for example, let's think about bananas. You all like bananas, okay? So, you might eat a banana for breakfast because you enjoy it. Would you consider the banana a food or a medicine? It's a food. You've got horrible diarrhea. You eat a banana because you want to stop the diarrhea. Is that a food or medicine? Medicine. Or a medicinal food. It's kind of in that order. So you have the same plant can be along this continuum or this sliding scale of relevance depending on how it's used and how it's valued. Okay. So spices fall oftentimes on this sliding scale. In some cases, they're used just as a way of increasing the pleasure of consuming the dish. In other cases, they might be added to improve the health value or the medicinal activity of what you're eating. Okay. So that's the food medicine. If you're interested in that, I teach a lot about that in the other course. Okay. Smell is incredibly important. In fact, if you had tasted any of these with your nose closed, it's going to taste very different than when you have your nose open. So you have nerves that go into your oral cavity through the nose that are important to detecting these secondary metabolites. I'm going to keep saying secondary metabolites. Let me just define what those are. Plants produce compounds that are necessary for their basic growth and survival. These are compounds that are involved in things like photosynthesis. Go back to high school biology, right? Then they also produce these extra compounds, like these compounds that you're smelling, these volatile oils. Those are secondary metabolites. For a very long time, secondary metabolites were thought to just be waste products or something unimportant. It's amazing how scientists sometimes get things so wrong. But now we know that secondary metabolites are critical to the plant's ability to survive in an environment. So it improves their ability to deal with pests, to defend themselves from, for example, microbial pathogens that could attack the plant, or to deter insects from eating too many of the leaves, or even mammals from eating the leaves, or they also could be used to attract different organisms to the plant. Remember, this is not Lord of the Rings. Plants can't get up and walk away from a threat, right? They're sessile. You guys get the Lord of the Rings references? That too. Okay. They cannot get up and like fight whatever is hurting them. They have to stay still. So the way that they do that is by using this chemical language to communicate with the rest of their world. Okay? And humans and animals have learned to take advantage of some of these secondary metabolites for the betterment of our health and our own defense. And that's what medicinal plants and medicinal botany is all about, is us learning how to take advantage of those secondary metabolites. Okay. Spices are different from other plants in that they have something in common in that they contain high levels of these aromatic compounds. So they have a more concentrated smell and taste in them than, for example, lettuce. Take lettuce and compare that to, for example, lemon balm, and you're going to have a very different organoleptic experience, right? So lettuce doesn't have that big kick of chemistry. We have a bunch of spices here. I'll try to use by the end of the lecture. We'll see who recognizes what. Now, when it comes to our main crops, a lot of these allelochemical, by the way, is another term for secondary metabolite that has a purpose of interacting with other organisms. So in many cases, these allelochemicals that are produced by plants for their defense have been bred out of our foods, bred out of our plants, right? Why would we want to do that? Let's think about corn. What was corn like when Europeans first came to the Americas?
Smaller.
Smaller. Started out really small. Okay. Not as sweet. What color was corn originally? It was multicolored. You had purples, you had reds. Anybody remember from the previous class what those colors indicate, which chemical type? Antioxidants and specifically anthocyanins. Those are your dark purples and reds. Okay, so there were these dark purples and reds. They weren't very high in sugar content, and they may have tasted a little bit different also. Sometimes we've also bred out these compounds because they taste bitter. And we humans have a natural desire for salty, sweet, fat things, right? So we've selected for the sweet, white corn, so it doesn't have any of that antioxidant value that the original corn would have had. And this happened through a number of our crops. So another example here is, let's think about comparing a spice, like a chili pepper, to crop food like a potato. Can you eat as much chili pepper as you can a potato? No, right? That's like where we're defining that's a spice. You would use it to add some flavor to the potato, but in itself, you wouldn't want to eat that hot chili pepper with high levels of capsaicin. Here are some definitions of spices. The spice, as it's defined in the food industry, is the dry parts of a plant, including the roots, leaves, and seeds, that impart a flavor and pungent stimuli. Okay? Do these also impart flavor? Yes, but the clue here is these are fresh. So this is a culinary herb. The fresh bit of aromatic leaves or seeds of non-woody temperate plants. These are all herbs. They're herbaceous. They're not fig trees that we're blending these from. And then condiments are mixtures of those. So when you think of a condiment, what comes to mind?
Ketchup.
Mustard is maybe a better example because it's much more pungent, right? Ketchup is basically sugar. Okay. But you have the pungent mustard taste as a condiment. Anybody enjoy eating Indian food? Right? What kind of things go into that for your sides or chutneys? Right? We have these condiments that are dense and a lot of spices as well. You wouldn't sit there and eat an entire bowl of chutney on its own, right? Probably not. maybe just like for a big chutney eater or mustard eater, but normally we don't.
Would salt and pepper be condiments?
Those would be spices. Well, Pepper is a dried bits of a plant. Salt is not. Salt is kind of in its own category. Actually, and one of the students that came to see me yesterday in office hours asked me about some book recommendations, and I'm going to try and remember this up on Canvas, because there's an amazing book called Salt. It's all about the history of salt. It goes along with another book called Cod. You're like, why would I want to read a book about fish? That's what I said when one of my old professors told me this, but I loved it. It was fascinating history of fisheries, and salt is a fascinating history of not just where salt was mined, how it was made, but also it's tied closely to spices and to food preservation. So that's a really good book. I'll put those in the list.
Did you say that spices also have a high concentration of aromatic compounds?
Yes. So I would sprinkle dried chili powder on my food, but I wouldn't do that with potato powder, right? So there's a difference in like the flavor, those aromatic flavor imparting compounds that we're looking for. Here are some of the families that are known to have, or commonly have a lot of these different spices. So let's go through these. I want you to repeat after me because I want you to be able to say the tamarind. Okay, so Amaryllidaceae.
Amaryllidaceae
is where you're going to find all of your onions, garlics, leeks, these kind of plants, okay? Chives.
Zingiberaceae.
Zingiberaceae is where you find your gingers, your turmeric, right? And those are all, and cardamom as well, really lovely spice. Orchidaceae. That's where vanilla comes from. Your vanilla bean is actually a structure of an orchid. Okay. Lamiaceae. This is Lamiaceae right here. Okay. This one is Apiaceae. Caraway, celery, coriander, cumin, dill. Right. And if you look at these, they do have a little bit of overlap in flavor.
Hyperaceae.
That's black pepper. Now, what about red pepper? Red pepper is not on that list because it's part of the Solanaceae. Your Solanaceae is where you find potatoes, tomatoes, chili peppers, bell peppers, any kind of pepper other than black pepper is in your Solanaceae. How about for those of you that like mustard? Brassicaceae. So there you have those really pungent horseradish and mustard taste. These are more of the aromatic, kind of sweet smelling ones that go into desserts. So Myristicaceae, mace, and nutmeg. Where do these come from? Did you do the reading? You should know the answer. The Banda Islands. Are they from different plants? It's the same plant, and it's the same plant. It is Myristica fragrans, and we're going to see a picture. So the mace is actually a red arrow that goes around the seed or the nut that we call nutmeg. So it kind of envelops it, this red hood.
In the reading, it said that the mace and nutmeg from orchids.
It's not from orchid. No.
Oh, so it's just that's just what they called it
in the reading. Orchards?
Yeah, orchards.
Orchards is like, an orchard would be like a plantation of where you planted a bunch of trees. Orchid is like you're showing orchids that you have. You get the store that has a beautiful kind of flowers you can that are used to decorate boxes and stuff, right? That's a different plant family. And then orchards are clusters of trees they cultivated. Good question. Yeah.
Cashews in the Myristaceae family?
Cashews are in the Anacardiaceae family, I believe. Where are they at? So, yeah, it's not listed there. But cashews wouldn't really be a spice.
Yeah, I'm wondering because they have the same sort of thing as nutmeg, where they're a seed inside of a sort of, what is the word that I'm looking for? The flesh around it is very caustic.
Well, and you have, in the anacardiac is where we also have poison ivy, is where we have mangoes, it's where we have pepper tree. So another kind of pepper, an anacard pepper, not hydrolyc, not solanaceae. Yeah. Good question. Okay. All right. I'm going to just give a little nod to Linnaeus before we go on, just so you can kind of keep track again of this. When Dr. Samar can lecture next Thursday, you're going to really get into this deeply. I just want to bring this back up. So you have the division of names. Let's take, for example, Papaver somniferum. What plant is that? What's the common name of that? And what compound comes from it? Does anybody know? Opium poppy. Morphine is the drug. All those opiates come from Papaver somniferum. Somniferum means sleep, right? And if you eat enough poppy, you will go to sleep for like ever. So this is how you write it. Papaver is a genus, and you have the capital letter in the beginning, and it's in italicized. Somniferum is all lowercase, it's a species in italics, and then L stands for Linnaeus. Now you're going to have other letters after some of these plant names that stand for the other author epithets, the people who named the plant. You need to be making note cards. Have you read your study text for the class? Have a little nice little helpful hint in the orientation module. Make a note card that has on it Papaver somniferum equals opium poppy, has this compound, and this is how it works throughout class. Build on that knowledge set, that way it'll help you study. Okay? You do not need to know every single plant that's listed in the readings. That would be too much for you. Focus only on the ones that we really covered in class. Okay. So this is it. It talks about how these are related, Papaverales, Papaveraceae. Why do I care about how these are related? Who cares?
Wouldn't care if it's not similar, if they're more related.
Could be. Why would their medicinal properties possibly be similar? What do they share when they're related?
Phylogeny. Habitat.
They might share similar chemistry. Why would they share similar chemistry?
Phylogeny and common ancestry.
Common ancestry and common biosynthetic pathways, right? Plants have specialized enzymes that make these compounds in their leaf structures versus in their root structures. Each tissue will be producing different types of compounds. But when you have similarities, so take for example, if I take lemon balm, Melissa officinalis, and here I have ostimum, sanctum, even though they're not in the same genus, this is ostimum, this is Melissa, is the genus. They are in the same family, that's the next level up, Lamiaceae. Now I know that the citrusy, lemony smell that's very strong in lemon balm comes from a compound that's known as limonene. It's an essential oil compound, it's a very aromatic compound. Ostimum, sanctum, also has low levels of limonene. They share similar biosynthetic pathways. I am not going to find limonene, however, in the cashew and the anacardiaceae. It's not in that plant. Now you can have compounds that appear across different families. Also, especially if they share a common order. Okay, so at each level that you go up, you're less and less likely to have similar chemistry. If I'm comparing multiple species within Papaver, so let's take Papaver roes, which is a red corn poppy, with Papaver somniferum. Am I going to find similar opiate compounds in both plants? Yes. The difference is that roes has much lower levels. So you can eat a lot of corn poppy and never get the effects that you would have if you ate like the poppies of Papaver somniferum. But they do have low levels of those compounds present. Okay? Now let's think about some of these pungent compounds. Here's some more structures. If you'll notice that these that kind of start going towards the sharp flavor, think of wasabi, think of onion, horseradish, mustard, garlic. What do these share? They often contain a sulfur. Remember I mentioned like the presence of certain things can impart that that pungence, that sharpness to the flavor. How many of you like to eat wasabi? So, I'm going to tell you a hard truth. You probably never in your life actually had real wasabi. Okay? Real wasabi is a higher value commodity. Maybe if you went to like a super duper fancy sushi restaurant, you pay a lot of money to get it. But most wasabi that you get, like when you go to Cox Hall, it's actually horseradish. It's dyed green. Okay. And it has like the same similar flavors. Okay. But it's not real wasabi. I've had real wasabi in a garden in the Netherlands. I like harvested some of it. It's nice. But yeah. So it's kind of fun. Why don't we just call it horseradish? You know, why do they have to call it wasabi? It's a total lie. Good question.
Is real wasabi a separate plant or it's a type of wasabi?
We're really different species. Yeah, different plant. It's not horseradish. Yeah. Horseradish is cheap, so you cultivate, you grow. So it's an economics driver. Yeah.
So I know that, I'm curious, I've heard that for some people with heart problems, they're not supposed to have sulfites. So with things like onions, horseradish, and mustard,
and there's food, they're not, it's not the same thing as sulfite and sulfur compounds. But it does have relevance to the heart because actually there is blood thinning properties of some of the compounds in garlic, for example. If you are on blood thinners, or if you someday, if you're a pharmacist or physician or a nurse or any kind of medical care provider, and you have a patient on blood thinners, you would want to advise them on their diet not to eat high levels of fresh garlic. Fresh garlic is going to have more of those pungent sulfur-based compounds that have blood-thinning properties. So in that case, you can get what's called an herb-drug interaction, where you're augmenting or increasing the level of blood-thinning activity they have in their body. Right? That's a good question. Now let's move to the hot. In the hot, we have compounds like capsaicin, which is found in the Solanaceae family. So your hot chili peppers, those red peppers. Piperine, on the other hand, is more really commonly found in the Piperaceae family. So, have you ever had kava before? Kava? You're going to in class. We're going to have kava in class. kava tastes a little bit like dirt, peppery dirt. Aren't you excited? It's like muddy water when you drink it properly. And it leaves this peppery sensation in your mouth. Your mouth actually will go numb after you drink enough of it, and it has a muscle relaxing property. I know you guys are like, oh, I can't wait to taste this. You can have a little bit, it's fine, you won't go completely numb. But that peppery flavor is due to the piperine that's found in the plant. And then the relaxant properties are due to these other compounds called cavalactones. We'll get into it later. So here you have the scale, again, on chemistry, and we know from our taste, we know that mustard and horseradish have a little bit of a similar taste, right? We can classify that when we think about our tasting, and it all comes down to the chemistry of the plant. The things that these plants are making to defend themselves from parasites and pests, or to attract pollinators or seed dispersers to them. Now, what are some of the pharmacological activities of spice plants? Well, they can help to stimulate body heat production. So if you think about, if you eat like a whole bunch of chilies, anybody ever done that? Right? You're like, oh, I'm strong, eat a bunch of chilies. And you're like, what happens? Do you feel hot? You do get hot. What happens to your face? It turns red. Why does it turn red? Vasodilation. You have your blood vessels are opening more, okay? So there's a reason that you turn red. It's a pharmacological activity, and you have a physiological response to the peppers. I once ate something. It was very tiny when I was in Sumatra, and it was like a chicken satay with some kind of sauce. I started leaking from all of my facial orifices, snot, tears, saliva, and I just didn't know what to do. I was like, milk or something. She brought me watermelon juice. Actually works like a charm. So if you ever have too much of a reaction to hot chili peppers where you're just like, you know, watermelon juice helps to quench the heat. And I don't know why it does that. That'd be an interesting chemistry question to look into. So they can influence, some of them can influence peripheral blood pressure. They can promote lipid metabolism, like we talked about with the garlic also. They can affect metabolic regulation, enhance digestion, and peristalsis. So here's an idea. Instead of taking caffeine boosted supplements or whatever you take to get a better workout, why not throw a little extra chili pepper on your food? There's a great way to regulate your diet, right, through the use of the appropriate foods to boost your metabolism, right, without having to take supplements. Just make your food a little bit spicier. Add some more antioxidant compounds or things that inhibit inflammatory pathways like turmeric to your diet. Now, this is the other thing that's interesting. Spices are often very rich in antioxidants. Anybody remember why? What did we talk about the other day? What happens? What is this?
Phenol.
Yeah, it's a phenol. You've got like a benzene ring here. What you can do is they can donate that hydrogen, form a double bond, and restabilize, right? Whereas with other areas where they steal protons, like from your different parts of the cell, of the lipid layer of the cell wall, that creates kind of a chain reaction. So these can stably donate protons, and that's why they make such great antioxidants. Okay, let's do a history lesson. Anyone ever been to Egypt?
I went to Cairo, Alexandria, kind of like all along the Nile.
Oh, that's amazing. I have not been to Alexandria yet, but I love Egypt. What's great about Egypt when it comes to spices or oils? Did you go to any of the essential oil factories?
No, but we went to Spice Market.
Spice Market, they all have spice, love dry spices. Also in Morocco, you've got these huge spice markets, big pallets, woven things that have, you know, big piles of spices. Well, this is not a new phenomenon. You have evidence of spices, and importantly, spice trade in ancient Egypt as evidenced by some of their hieroglyphs. So this is a painting in Luxor, and here you have Ramses III offering incense. Where does incense come from? Spice plants, right? So a lot of these spices, though, interestingly, you had some of them locally, but a lot of them came from far away. They weren't native to Egypt. The Egyptians were skilled perfumers. If you ever do get a chance to go to Egypt, make the trip to visit one of these shops where they make the perfumes and the essential oils from the plant materials. Really lovely. I still have some from, when was I there? I was there in 2003, and they're still very aromatic. So these were used by ancient Egyptians for a lot of different purposes, ranging from cooking, medicine, cosmetics, and mummification. When we think of ancient Egypt, we all jump to mummification. Mummification would not be possible without these plants. And this also helped to drive some of those early explorations of Egyptians to other locations towards the Arabian Peninsula. So, in mummification, they use spices like myrrh and cassia and cinnamon, anise, and cumin. These will all go into the body cavity. Now, what's interesting about these is, yes, they're aromatic, but a lot of these are also antibacterial. Right? So what happens to the body when you have a dead body? What happens inside if you leave the gut intact?
It rots,
kind of explodes, the bacteria continue to, you know, it bloats. Right? So one of the first things they would do is they would remove the internal organs, and they would treat them also with these spices, and then would go into jars, and they would treat the internal part of the cavity with these antibacterial cocktails of spices. Okay? What's interesting, though, again, these are not native to Egypt, many of these are not, so how did they get a hold of them? And this is a map of the some of the ancient tree roots. Okay? So here you have, just for reference, your geography is not up to scratch. You've got the Nile River here. Here's the Red Sea. Here is Italy, right? You've got Turkey over here. Here's Alexandria. Here's Cairo. And you have sites like Luxor. These things are all along the Nile here. So what they would do is they had both land and ships. They would go into areas like around the Arabian Peninsula. This is modern-day Yemen. Over here is Oman. Here you have sponsored by fancy cars and stuff, right? It's here. And this is all a very arid desert-like place. This is where you can find plants like frankincense and myrrh. Now, what's interesting about frankincense and myrrh, we'll get to those in a bit, is that they have to be actively managed because it's actually plant resin. And I actually had some of it. I went to Lebanon this year, and I had some resins. I forgot them at home, so sorry. I'll try to remember to bring my back next class. So they're traveling to these places. A lot of the spices are coming from this part of the world, right around here. So what did this do? The ancient spice trade helped to foster interactions, intercultural actions between many different populations. So you had interactions with traders between Egypt and Greece and the Roman Empire and Southeast Asia. There's evidence of trade between Egypt and China going back to 1400 BC. And this crisscrossed again over Arabia and India. So these are the kind of areas where they would crisscross over. You mentioned Alexandria earlier. Alexandria, and this was located again right up here. Where is Alexandria? This is a great port of entry into the Roman Empire throughout this area, right? And it remained an important route or an important port for many, many years. So in Alexandria, there's evidence that they were trading black pepper and ginger and cinnamon from India, and again, going through these Arab intermediaries. And so that was a big point of cultural diversity as well, with all these different trades happening. One of the reasons I love working in the Mediterranean, and especially on these islands that are found, you know, between Sicily and the North African coast, is that these islands were once colonized by many, many different cultures in the past. And so in the end, you end up with this kind of mishmash culture, mishmash way of dealing with the natural world that's very different from mainland Italians. Here's another important port that was a major maritime trade center on the Red Sea. So we have Berenike up here, Alexandria, there's Cairo. And what's neat about this is that archaeologists have found evidence of old markets where you had inscriptions in 11 different languages. Think about that. That is a really global market where you had people bringing and trading spices in 11 different languages. So this is a question. Could this be an example of globalization at this point in time, right? They're taking resources from different places and bringing them to different places. So why were spices so important? What did we not have during this period? We did not have refrigeration. Food preservation and food security was of utmost importance, especially when you're living in these urban centers. These people are no longer as nomadic. They're living in these cities where you need to have access to fresh food, and you need to be able to store that food once you have it. So salt, obviously, was a big important means of preserving food for a long time. But these plant spices also were incredibly important. So, for example, you had condiments like in relishes, nutmeg and mace were important for this, for foods. Food preservation. They would also, so you can imagine meat that's been butchered, you might want to coat it in these spices to help again with what kind of activities. They have, many of these spices are potent antibacterials and antifungals, okay? So they're spicy. They're also using it to cover up the smell of rancid meat. So imagine you've got some hamburger that's been out for like a week outside, right? Throw some spice on it, try and cover up that taste. Probably not a good idea. They're probably really sick to do that. But that's what they had to do, right? That is cover up that the smell of some of these putrid foods. And black pepper and cardamom were really good for that. Have you ever smelled cardamom before? See if I have some here. Part of our spice game, but I'll take this out. I'm going to take this around. Cardamom is really lovely. I'm going to crush one up to help release some of that smell. These have been in a jar for like a year, so they may not be super fresh. But you can get the idea. You can pass that around to cardamom. So imagine coating your meat in this smell, or that of black pepper also. And then they also use all these spices as medicines, right? Straight up to treat different afflictions and cure them. They were used also as ointments to treat different skin problems and wounds and so on. And they also use them to fortify wine. So if you've ever heard of spiced wine, they use this to help preserve the wine and preserve the taste of the wine. Other applications were for aromatics, for also as these oils used in bathing or to conceal body odor. They didn't have any deodorant back then, right? So, and you're out in the heat for a while, all those bacteria start to make people stink pretty bad. And so they would use things like sandalwood and balsam and cloves, if you smell cloves and have that perfume. There were also poison antidotes. They were used to help cleanse garments. So this is where incense also played an important role, was by burning some of the spices, releasing the smoke that was used to disinfect or get rid of bad spirits in the house, freshen the air in the house, or help freshen your clothes. Again, we talked about embalming. Also, painting was, these were very important. Spices like saffron and turmeric were very important for painting. Here's some examples of these resin compounds. This is myrrh. Myrrh is in the Burstaceae family, and the Latin name is, of the genus, is Comophora, but Comophora, there are multiple species of Comophora that are used as myrrh, including Gileadensis. So these are found especially in the Arabian Peninsula. We talked about this before, where you had the Egyptians going down into what's now modern-day Yemen looking for this. And it was also sold as something called the Balm of Gilead, right? So when you look at ancient texts and you're trying to understand ancient systems of medicine, they weren't writing the text. Well, this is, this, you know, Comophora, you know, mobile for this thing. They had different names, different common names. This is Balm of Gilead. And this was used in mummification, for religious applications, and also as an analgesic. That's a new term. What's an analgesic?
Pain reliever.
Pain reliever, right? So it was used to help relieve pain, especially for oral health. So they would add this to wine and use that to rinse the mouth as both an antiseptic and a pain reliever for tooth pain. Tooth pain in dentistry was a big issue then as well, because again, if you had an infection or an abscess, tooth would be incredibly painful. Got many options for treatment. Now we know there's evidence of myrrh in some of these ancient pieces of art. I find this fascinating. You have the myrrh-bearing women in Sicily, and then this is from the 12th century. And then you also have hieroglyphs in Luxor in the temple of these men carrying myrrh trees. They were not only going and collecting the resin itself and buying it from traders in places like that very bottom tip of the Arabian Peninsula, but they were also trying to transplant and cultivate those trees in Egypt because they were so important to their culture, to their different religious practices. Then you have frankincense. This is in, again, the Burseraceae family. The genus is Boswellia. These also share the common application, where these are plant resins. So you can see this guy, he's harvesting, he's making incisions into the tree. The way that these are managed is much like you would tap rubber. Have you ever seen like a rubber tree tapped where it oozes out of latex? With rubber trees, it's more liquid and it goes into a bucket. With these trees, it's a little bit more dense, but you're basically collecting the resin. Have you ever cut into a pine tree and saw the stuff ooze out? Some of you, right? Go cut a pine tree today. Find them on the campus. Don't tell them I sent you. But just do a little something, or like break the twig in half and touch that sticky resin. Okay? That's what they're doing, is they're harvesting resin to use as medicine. And then it's a great spice because once it's dried properly, you know, this stores really well. It will last a very long time. So it was very amenable to transportation. Some of the other spices that were coming for further across, so we're moving past the Arabian Peninsula into India and Sri Lanka, were things like cinnamon, black pepper, cardamom, and a lot of the gingers. The gingers originated in Asia. Cardamom is within that same family. You're passing around cardamom right now, okay? You're smelling cardamom. Cinnamon actually comes from the bark of the tree, okay? So this is interesting also. Why are these all dry? I had the opportunity when I was in Hawaii to harvest some fresh allspice. It smelled amazing. I'm like, why don't they sell it like this? Fresh. Why?
Difficult to transport.
Typical of transport, it would rot if it's not properly dried beforehand, and so they do maintain some of those aromatic, potent aromatic qualities even in their dry form. This is why these spices were always dry, right? Now, there was a huge demand for these exotic spices. Think about Europe during this period. They were relying heavily on local plants that were in the APAC. So your carrots and your celeries, you had some of the amaryllidaceae, your onions. You didn't have potatoes yet. Where did potatoes come from? From the Americas or in the Peruvian highlands. You didn't have tomatoes. Italian food had no tomato sauce until post-1492, right? It was all based on eating a lot of wild greens, grains, and some of these other local vegetables. So there was a real craving for the exotic. These are really exotic things. And so when you had this very intricate spice trade, we already showed you the picture of the map. And then when you have the fall of the Roman Empire, one of the things that made this so possible is that you had a common governing body over a wide swath of land. When the Roman Empire fell, it led to a decline in that trade. And then in the Dark Ages, they turned really to Mediterranean natives, and then some of these were cultivated in the monastic gardens. Now, there are some valuable plants that are from the Mediterranean. One of the most valuable is saffron. Saffron, and this is a picture of it. It's a very small little plant. The part of saffron that is valued are the stigma. So it says, this is for sale. You see, hand. This is a stigma. So imagine plucking each of those. That's why it's so valuable, because you have to do manual harvest. It's not automated by machinery. And it's a very small amount. But it confers a beautiful color to the food, and also is used in art. Again, we talked about Laniaceae and Apiaceae were the other main herb sources at this point. So what's interesting is we came out of these Dark Ages, and then there was a resurgence of an interest in the exotic. So following the Crusades, this is after 1090, what was happening in the Crusades, you had these Europeans in the Middle East that were, again, had access to all these wonderful exotic plants and spices. And when they came back, they wanted to bring those back into Europe. So this is the period when Venice and Genoa became huge trade centers in Europe. Anybody ever been to Venice or Genoa? Right? So you've got, you're right on the water, on opposite sides of Italy, okay? And they became incredibly wealthy because of these trade systems. It was a shipping port for entryway into Europe for all these spices. They became really important for spices like nutmeg and mace. Now, what's interesting, these, of course, are coming from the same plant. Nobody really knew where nutmeg and mace came from. The traders that were dealing with this, because it was a secret. It was a big secret. They didn't want the location released. Okay. And the wealth that was generated from this trade helped to fund the Renaissance. So you have all the great artists. When you go to Venice and Genoa, you see these beautiful paintings. All of this was funded through this. This is a picture of cinnamon bark collected by the Dutch in India. Then you have the spice islands, the secret spice islands. Nobody knew where they were. On the other side. So here you have nutmeg. This inside is what becomes the nut. On the outside, that red arrow kind of hugs the nut. That is mace. This is nutmeg. Same plant, literally just two different little bits of the same plant. Okay? This is also, I believe, edible, the outside coat, this outer part, but it does not store well. So this was not really entered into trade. So in 1453, you had the capture of Constantinople by the Turks. So you had the Turks that were starting to come up during this period into the Balkans. You can picture where Italy is, and across the sea, you have Greece. Albania, Macedonia, Kosovo, Serbia, all these, this area here, the Turks started invading there. And when they did that, that also happened to be one of the major trade routes to get access to these spices. And so they lost their supply of nutmeg. And this was one of the reasons why others decided to try and find other routes to get back to these products because of their high demand. Now, in years before, this is 1453, years before, Marco Polo, you've all heard of Marco Polo? Where in the world is Marco Polo? He spent a lot of time traveling, right? He's most well known for his travels and work with the Mongolian herdsmen. But he, in his travels, came across the Banda Islands. And guess what? He wrote about it in his book. His book was aptly called Travels. And it was actually, he told his story to Rusticello, who is this writer from Paris, who basically interviewed him while he was in prison, because he got caught up in this conflict between Venice and Genoa. Venice and Genoa, again, were what? They were like the two major competing centers for trade and spice routes. This all comes down to money. Okay, so later on, this is somebody didn't discover how to get to the trade route. The Portuguese were the first to find out. There was a marriage between the Portuguese and the Dutch, so the Dutch found out, and they found their way to the Banda Islands. Now, this is the additional reading I gave you. This is a really good story. I want you guys to read that. I'm not going to tell you too much about it in class because I want you to read the story. I'll just say that when they went to the Spice Islands, they had a horrific effect on the local people. They at first tried to work with them, then there was an altercation. They fought back, and the Dutch came back and basically killed everybody and enslaved the ones that they left to live. So it was a horrific example of what happens when you have a valuable commodity held by a disempowered indigenous group. Are there examples of that today? Where? Give me an example. So easy. Think about the Amazon. What's happening to the Amazon right now? Oil, gold, timber, right? People are being driven out. Actually, and they just approved new roads to go through big chunks of the Amazon. With roads comes more people coming in to cut out these lands. So this is not a new story, this idea of having people's commodities really lead to a horrible outcome. But read that for me. These are some of the early examples of nutmeg I found in the archives of the Museum Naturalis in Leiden. And here's mace. Here's nutmeg, mercica fragrance. It was really interesting to see these original samples from some of the early explorers in the area. So let's talk about the Americas next. So this is all happening in Europe and over in Indian Asia. When they found America, basically by trying to find a new route to their spice sources, they came into other spices. So this is where we finally had an introduction of all these solanaceous plants, the chili peppers, potatoes, tomatoes. But for this, the purpose of this course, we're going to talk about capsicum, which is a source of chili peppers. They have the vanilla beans, and also allspice, the myrtaceae, came into trade at that point. Now, what's interesting here is if you look at how different cultures have used these spices, they've used them in similar ways. So if you have the ginger, common ginger is, this is just Zingiber officinale, is the common ginger, which hopefully you've all tasted at some point in your life or cooked with. It's a really nice spice. But there are all these other related, or even in different genera within the Zingiberaceae that were used in a similar way. And then there's also this idea of typical spices associated with different cuisines. So when you think of Mexican food, what do you think of? Chili peppers, cilantro, maybe garlic and onion, right? What do you think of when you think of Thai food? The cacio and lime, the hot chili peppers, right? Chinese food, Indian food. Now in some cases, these are using plants that originally were found in that area. So in Indian food, you've got things like turmeric and cinnamon and cardamom that were found in that part of the world. What was not found in that part of the world? The chili peppers. So red chili peppers displaced a lot of the black pepper market when they came out. And you can see that they got integrated into many, many different cuisines because of their appealing impact on the body. And so in summary, we have this long history of use of all of these different spices in different cultures. We know that they've been trading in plants for a long time. We know that they are using them not just for food or for pleasure, but for a number of different important roles for medicine, for embalming, as antibacterials before they even knew about antibacterials. I mean, think about that. How would they have known they could take this mixture of antibacterial spices and put them in the body cavity and help better preserve the body? Probably through a lot of experimentation, right? And you know, there were negative outcomes from this trade as well. Here's your terminology review. Now we're going to play our spice game. Okay, ready? Spice game.